Notice what we're talking about here. It's a horrible crime. Three teams are involved in the horrible crime. It is sin. It has been done. We cannot ignore it. We cannot just put aside or talk about it softly with political correctness. No, there's three guilty people. Watch carefully with me. Who are the three guilty people? Watch on the screen with me, please. Number one.
One, pagan African chiefs. Two, Muslim Arabs. Three, the Europeans.
Here's the fact, Brother Joseph.
Yeah.
Three equal guilty. The black chief,
yeah.
The African guy who sold
his own people,
the Muslim Arab who bought them on the ships, traveling with them
and
all over the world,
sold them to the Europeans,
and the European who bought them
yeah.
from the Arab slave traders.
Yeah,
here's the sad news, and it is a black days to even think about this. How this happened, and how these people were guilty. Three of them were guilty. Okay, continue with the history. Obviously, it's very important this year.
It's been quite a cover-up, though, hasn't it?
Yes, indeed.
The years.
Yes, indeed. Yes, indeed. Brother Joseph, can you read the slide for me, please?
Yeah.
If you guys can put this on the screen. Yes.
There it is. There are many abolitionists who fought against slavery in America, like John Brown, Dr. David Nelson, and Harriet Beecher Stowe. There were thousands of white Americans who died in the Civil War for the cause of freedom.
You know what's amazing in America?
Freedom for slaves.
For slaves. Yeah. For slaves. Yeah. What the problem we have here in America is they talk about everything wrong happened during the slavery.
Yeah.
But I have not seen a movie about none of these people's names.
Yeah.
So many of them have died to free slaves.
Yeah.
And we don't talk about the thousands, I mean literally thousands of Americans mm-hmm. who die in the Civil War to free the slave.
Hundreds of thousands.
I mean, I'm sure hundreds of thousands, hundreds of thousands. Why we don't talk about them?
No.
Can anybody compare the hundreds of thousands of white Americans who died to free the black slave and tell me how many Muslim men and women who died to free any slave?
Amazing.
There's no comparison. We're talking about a complete opposite side, 180 degrees. As far as the east is from the west is the fact and the truth we're talking about here.
Amazing.
All right. We'll continue a little bit more about Sharia law and slavery, Islamic law and slavery. Here we go.
The Quran clearly states that female slaves can be sexually enjoyed by their masters. Muhammad himself owned many slaves, some of whom he captured in wars of conquest and some that he purchased. Muslim historians record the names of 40 slaves owned by Muhammad.
40 slaves by Muhammad.
And you know what's amazing when you listen to the black Muslim or the Muslim in America, they will tell you, yes, he bought 40 and more. He bought them to set them free.
To set them free.
That's a hope. He didn't want to have a slave. That's not what we're going to see in the hadith. That's not what the Quran teach. Muhammad did not buy slaves to set them free. And Muslims do not buy slaves to set them free. That's a lie. Muslims are telling to you, my dear black brothers and black sisters, to make you hate the white, hate the Christian, and become Muslim. That is a lie, as we're going to see. What the Quran teach about what your right hand possessed, and what the hadith, what Muhammad did, concerning having slave himself or getting upset when somebody set a slave free. Let's continue. Move on. Here we go.
Islamic law, Sharia, contains many elaborate regulations for slavery.
There's a set of rules. Remember in the Bible when we talk about what the Bible said in the book of Leviticus, the book of Deuteronomy,
yes.
How you showed, what you not showed, there's law and rules has been set. In Islam, in Islamic law, Sharia Islamiyah, we do have laws. Listen carefully. That's not a man-made thing. It is Islamic law. It is Sharia law.
Right.
For example, here we go. Number one.
One, a slave had no right to be heard in court. Testimony was forbidden by slaves.
That's number one. Number two.
Two, slaves had no right to property.
You don't own land or homes in Islam. Number three.
Three, they could get married only with the permission of their master.
And you know what's amazing about it? They can get married with the permission of the master. Allah in the Quran teach, here is a slave of me, Muhammad or whatever his name is, and I got him married. I can share his wife with him. Can you imagine that? A man will get married that the master say, hey, Muhammad boy, yes sir, send your wife to me in bed. I need her right now. Can you imagine this with me? that in Islam, according to the teaching of the Quran, a Muslim man can share the slave. The Quran clearly teaches you cannot have sex with married woman except what your right hand possesses. If you have a slave and he has a wife, you can share his wife with him. So I don't even know why a Muslim man will get, why a slave will marry in Islam. Number four.
Four. They were considered to be property.
Number five.
Five. Owners were specifically entitled by Sharia law to sexually exploit their slaves, including hiring them out as prostitutes.
Not only a man can have a slave, even the Quran teach. You can, as a Muslim man, if you have 10, 15 girls in your house, a slave, you can run a house of prostitution. And Allah said what in the Quran? And Allah is forgiven, merciful, forgiven to such a thing. And it's amazing. We will get into these verses, by the way. We're not just making it up.
Yeah.
So if there's somebody who's watching and say, where is this verse? Show me in the Quran. I promise you. Every word we're saying in the show, we're going to prove it to you with the chapter and the verse and its interpretation. If you're interested by Muslim scholar, Ibn Kathir, Tabari, Qurtubi, Jalalain, or anybody else they choose to.
Yes.
We're going to get into Thomas Jefferson, if you don't mind, because it's a very important piece of history.
Yes.
We cannot talk about slavery in history and we'll forget about Thomas Jefferson.
The first war America ever fought as a nation.
Was Thomas Jefferson. And
what Thomas Jefferson learned from the Quran.
It's a very important question. By the way, Keith Ellison lied, and we're going to see in this next few slides here, about Thomas Jefferson and the Quran. Keith Ellison is trying to tell us that the reason Thomas Jefferson read the Quran because he believed in the Quran. There is wisdom, there is knowledge in the Quran. No, my friend. It is not what you think. Thomas Jefferson read the Quran because he want to know and learn about Islam and the truth about Islam. So, We will get into this piece as we go. Here we go. Here's a map, if you can watch with me. And the map here showing North Africa. The map here show North Africa. Start from Morocco all the way to Egypt into the right side. Next to it, we're going to read what we have here.
Muslim pirates who operated from along the northern shores of Africa, the Barbary Coast, attacked ships and raided towns in Europe from the 11th century until the 19th century.
That's how many years, Brother Joseph?
The 11th to the 19th, 800 years.
That's a long time, long time. 800 years, they were attacking the ships on this shore as we see it in North Africa.
So the Somali pirates today, is nothing new for Muslims.
No, we already have this in the past. We already have this for 800 years. And we'll see how it ended and how it's begin. Yeah. The reason it was there in the 11th century to the 19th century because Europeans were weak. Yeah. Europeans were giving money. Europeans were appeasing this country.
And they were fighting themselves in Western Europe.
Absolutely.
Too.
And today it's happening again in Somalia because America is weak and Obama is weak and Obama is appeasing the Somalia.
Yeah.
Do you know that after they start stealing our ships and doing this dirty work, the Patriots Wars, you know what's happening right now? We're giving Somalia more money. We're giving Sudanese more money. We're giving, I mean, what is exactly? We have not learned the lesson as Thomas Jefferson learned.
Even the liberal Clinton went into Somalia once after Bush first.
Absolutely.
Yeah, absolutely.
Continue with the history of this war.
As a young America began growing in terms of maritime trade, these Muslim terrorists were a constant threat, and America was forced to pay tribute money to appease the Muslim pirates.
We call them what? Muslim terrorists. When the word Muslim terrorist was used, it's between the 11th century to the 19th century. Let me give it back to you. It's actually the word terrorist began when you read the Quran in chapter 33, verse 26, 27, when Muhammad wrote or claimed that he received such a revelation from Allah. In the Quran, that's when the terrorization began. Terrorization did not begin September 11. No, terrorization began 1,400 years ago when Muhammad wrote the word terrorize the Jew and the Christian. So, obviously, this is the history here as we continue with it. Let's see what else happened with Thomas Jefferson.
To discuss the matter, American diplomats met with the ambassador from Tripoli. He was asked why the Muslims attacked American ships. The ambassador told them it was written in the Quran that all nations which had not acknowledged Muhammad were sinners, whom it was the right and duty of Muslims to plunder and enslave.
See, there was no political correctness then. The fact is, why do we have slaves? Thomas Jefferson wanted to know, the American leader at the time wanted to know why we have that. He said, it is written where? In the Quran. Can we get to Bush today? President Bush. When September 11 happened, did you ask some scholar or some people who's intelligent, some people who knows about the Quran, why this is happening? Have you ever heard what the Quran said, Mr. Bush and all the leaders of America, that the Quran teach? They must kill us. The Quran teach jihad is the duty of every Muslim. We did not win the war against jihad, and we will not win the war against jihad because simply we have not learned yet what is written in the Quran. That's a fact. So here we go in Thomas Jefferson Day.
Yeah.
They know what the Quran teaches. They asked the question, and the answer was given directly, openly, without political correctness. The Quran teach Muslims have the right to have slaves because Allah in the Quran said so.
Now, can you give them a verse now? Would you like me to give them a verse? Or are you
there are plenty of verses coming up, brother.
Okay,
we
have only 11 minutes left, and before the end of the show, I would like you to share at least a few of these verses from the Quran. I know you're going to share them tomorrow.
Yes.
Let me share one.
Oh, go ahead.
You're going to get to them tomorrow.
Absolutely. Go ahead.
Let me share one for those who are saying, well, where is this in the Quran? You'll get it tomorrow at 8:30 p.m. Eastern. But here's one in particular that I think that this ambassador was referring to, Surah 47.
Mm-hmm.
Surah 47, Surah Muhammad. how
the Book of
interesting.
Muhammad.
Yeah. Book of Muhammad, Surah 47, verse 4. Listen to what it says. This is the Shocker translation. So when you meet in battle those who disbelieve, smite their necks.
Yeah.
And when you have overcome them by causing it, no, I'm sorry. When you have overcome them, make them prisoners. What's this talking about? Make them slaves.
Yeah.
They're your slaves now.
I wish you read this in my translation a little bit better, but that's okay.
And
I forgive you, brother.
And afterwards, either set them free as a favor or let them ransom themselves war comes.
You know what's amazing? In the Quran, when Allah give Muslim options, which one do you think they're going to choose?
No, they're going to get ransom.
You got five slaves in your hand. You can get $100 from each one, or you just let them go for free. Which one do you think you're going to choose? As a man whom Allah gives you the right to keep them a slave, of course you're going to get some money out of them. But it's just the way the verse is written, and the options always Allah give to the Muslim for their own good.